and the stock's like, you know, almost man height. So the draw length is often half the stock. So it's, you're looking at bows that are shooting quite long bolts, which increases their efficiency because there's a longer push from the bowstring. The stocks are substantial, so possibly that helps with aiming. I don't know. But this all kind of matches what's being shown in the paintings, even though the paintings are done 400 years later.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, this is fairly consistent.
It's interesting for reproducing them, this information.
Yes, because this gives you a starter. If you know how long the bow is. See, in Korea, they have traditional crossbow stocks and bows that have survived from the time that they were used in warfare. When they make reproductions now, they copy the stock, but they replace the bow with the equivalent of a modern Korean target bow. And when I say modern, I mean traditional horn and sinew. But the actual bows that are associated with crossbows, and when I was in Korea, I saw in one of the museums several old crossbow lats were immensely thick and incredibly recurved. McEwen told me that one he was able to see inside because part of the lacquer covering had broken off. They didn't even have horn in them. They actually had a wooden belly. Oh. But the whole thing was tightly wrapped in sinew, which put everything under compression. And normally what happens with a wooden belly is that it collapses in like ribs and dies. But if it's compressed, it can't collapse. So it can only compress.
Okay.
And this is apparently what they did. It's also cheaper because you don't have to use horn. And I believe, because Korean crossbows, like what we know of Middle Eastern crossbows, had long draws, as did Chinese crossbows. And the early ones. I mean, you know, after the Han Dynasty, there was a lot of lost technology and crossbows kept re-emerging in China. And the draw lengths changed, and there was influence from Yunnan and the tribal people down there. So it became incredibly complex in China. You can't say just one thing. I'll just read a little of this so that people can understand. This is not something you can follow easily, and I'm not really sure what he's talking about. They based the power of the bow from the strongest to the weakest on a degree of the sky. Each degree consists of 60 minutes and has two round areas, which are the bow ears, until the fezangar of the bowstring. Unfortunately, we don't know what fezangar is. It may be the knot. Who knows? We don't. This reduces to 16. Each bow arm consists of three parts, and the bow handle is the center so that it does not move. The bow ears and the bow arms are its legs. Thus, the part where the shot stems from the bow ear, the power is double as much as the bow ear. Now, I don't know what that means. I think he knew what it meant. And I think he was talking about the leverage that the stiff tips gave to the bow and how that increased the power available to the arrow. But it's not really clear. And to kind of guess at what he means without being able to prove it. I mean, you can say, oh, well, we make a bow and this does this and this does that. Well, that says that could be what it means, but it isn't definitive until you can really understand it. And there's more numbers. And then he says one has divided both arms in six parts. This is because the face of the bow is a semicircle, and the semicircle of the sky consists of six constellations. So there's 12 zodiacal constellations. So the circle of the sky is half that, so it's six. It really doesn't make a lot of sense. But then he goes on to say, because the intention about the art of the bow and arrow is its appearance. I don't know what that means. I don't know what he means by intention and what he means by appearance, but he then goes on to say, and why the Persian kings required it during the New Year's festivities. Now, I think that he's saying that the bow had this relationship to the sky and the zodiac because of its shape and its changes in shape and its divisions. And because this is a book about New Year, Nowruz, that is why on Nowruz ceremonies that the bow is prominently displayed by the king. This is very difficult to understand, but you know, I'm not sure anything that you put down at this level. There may be esoteric meanings, but we don't know, and it's irresponsible to kind of make up things because they might fit. I point out in Persian, the section of the bow that bends. So in a bow, you've got the hand grip, which is rigid. You've got a section that bends, and then you've got a stiff tip that doesn't bend. Yeah. That bending section in Persian is called hame, and in Arabic is called bait. And they both mean house. Yeah. And when you read this with all the stuff, we're talking about astrological houses, not physical houses. We're talking about sections of the sky in curves. So they're linking this back. And since Khane and Bait are really old usages, they've been in use for that part of the bow limb for centuries, and probably for several hundred years before him, yeah. That means that this is a really old tradition. Based on astrology, they say that the owners of the bow and anyone who is an archer, so you could borrow a bow and be an archer, will never have a hard day, as any army that relies on arrows and has archers will be victorious. Well, as an archer, I have to agree. In fact, it didn't always happen that way, but they argue that this is because this weapon is based on Sagittarius, here we go, with a fire temperament, and is in the house of Jupiter and in a good constellation and in the triangle of Aries, Leo, and the house of the sun, and its honor is the house of Mars. Well, there you've got it. You've got your whole bow's astrological chart. Obviously, it's just really
fascinating,
good.
Isn't it, Bobbeat? It's really...
It's amazing how something as utilitarian as a bow can be tied into this very... esoteric knowledge of the stars and the universe and cosmology as it was understood at the time. Let's keep remembering, Omar Khayyam developed a solution for quadratic equations. He developed a way of getting cube roots. He basically wrote the modern Persian calendar, which I've seen several experts on calendar say is better than ours, is better than the Western calendar because it's more accurate. Yeah. And it, the way that it intercalates days and that is more efficient.
Yeah.
So he's a really intelligent man. So when he's doing this, there could be things in there that his readers, who were very advanced in these sciences and pseudosciences, would understand, where we, who are just normal people, have no idea.
Yeah. You're right.
Then he goes on to something a little bit more concrete. From the medical point of view, archery has some evident benefits for bodily health. One learns abstinence from it because one has to control one. You can't go madly out and just shoot. You've got to control your desires and concentrate and relax and empty your mind. It really is important. It strengthens the sinews and organs. Well, it seriously does good work for the upper body. If you're using breathing techniques, it also helps your abdomen. If you're doing, as they say with the stances, the straight stances and that, your back and everything is held in the right position. It is very good. If you're an office worker that sits hunched over a computer all day and do some archery, you will find that your back straightens and you get more upright. And your breathing improves because you're not kind of hunched in. makes the joints supple and flexible. Well, certainly those ones. But the interesting thing is, of course, the archery practiced in his time would involve horse archery, kneeling, sitting archery, possibly stances that were designed for running away or running towards. So you'd be in a position so you could leap forward or leap backwards. So that it was a little bit more gymnastic than modern archery is.
Yeah.
It helps concentration. Well, that's really obvious.
Obvious.
Makes a strong heart and prevents stroke, paralysis, and tremor. Now, modern medical science does not see archery as a cardio exercise because you don't stress the heart. You can do archery and maintain a resting heart rate if you're really good. But then modern archery is standing still and you know, locking yourself into a stance and then letting go. Whereas the archery he's talking about is full extension archery, and you're probably not just shooting on foot, but shooting on horseback. And to be honest, when I used to do horseback riding and a little bit of shooting, because I was a bad horseback rider and not a very good shooter back those days, horse archery is a really good exercise for your lower legs and everything, because you're gripping and you're doing a lot more. So maybe the archery of his time was actually good for all those bits.
Yeah.
I don't have too much trouble believing that.
Yeah.
Then he goes on to tell a couple of stories. These are interesting. There are two, basically. And he uses an unusual form of Anushavan, the nickname of Husrau, the first of the Sasanian Empire. He calls him Anushinravan.
Yeah.
But that's probably quite normal. And he says, one day a physician was advising his son, "Oh, my son, you should love horses and love bows, and you should not be without fortifications, and do not keep your fortifications without joists." And this is one of these little epigram things, right? He's not saying build a castle. And he explains, he answered, "Oh, father, I have understood the importance of the horse and the bow, but why fortifications and joists?" He answered, "The fortification is the warrior and the joist is the mail armor. It means that you should not remain without armor as far as you can." And I mean, you know, this is the heavy archer, probably. Well, this is the heavy horse archer. He's got a mail shirt,
Yeah. Possibly
bazard band. Back then, the bazard band were known. They weren't as common as they were later. And this is, you know, pretty basically. There's another one included in that paragraph. Saif Zay Yazan said that when Anushinravan sent the Iranian army leader, and he shot Abraha Sabah with an arrow and threw him off his horse, he, Saif Zay Yazan, said, "Oh, brothers, come to the right trajectory as the wind is blowing straight. And when the dead take away life from a living person, they are both bow and arrow. By the dead, the bow is dead. The arrow is dead. They're not living things."
Yeah.
So the dead taking away the life of a living person.
Yeah.
The arrow is no longer connected to you when it hits the target.
Yeah.
The arrow, the dead flying thing, is the thing that takes the life away from your enemy.
Yeah.
"Keep their customs and traditions as they are the wisest of weapons." This is the customs and traditions of archery.
Since
they are close in a fight, but kill enemies from a distance. And this is again, you see in the later Persian manuscripts,
they
were very aware of the fact that, you know, there's a real advantage to be able to get rid of your enemy before they even get close to you. So we're not talking about archery where you're just shooting light arrows that bounce off your enemy because you're shooting from too great a distance. They were expecting to do serious damage at their maximum engagement range, which means how far they could shoot a heavy enough arrow to do damage, which may have been 200 meters or 300 meters or more. It probably depended on the time and the bows and a lot of other things. Then the, So that was actually two. I should have called that one and two, and then three. So we'll say three. They say that one day Nushin Ravan asked Babak Arez, which types of weapon holders are the most famous? He answers, this is Babak, the owners of bows and arrows. Nushin Ravan was surprised and wanted to ask him to explain this detail and asked, how should these people be? He answered, all their bodies should be made of heart, courage. And their hearts should be made of arms, power. And all their arms should represent the bow, and all their bows should be arrows, and all their arrows should be in the heart of their enemies. And then he asked, how should one understand the meaning of this? And he answered, when they keep their hearts strong and their arms hard and the bowstring smooth and hard, like the bow, and keep the arrows straight and in line, thus the bowstring will find its place in the heart of the enemy. When all these are done this way, so far has been said about arrows and the bow. So that's the end of the chapter. So that little last one is interesting, because it's, again, getting back to what you see in the later manuscripts about, it's not just the bow and arrow, it's the man shooting the bow and arrow. It's the straightness, which can have two meanings, the uprightness of the man in terms of his moral uprightness, and the straightness of his stance, the straightness of the arrow. Again, something that was written 900 years ago, it's not always easy, even if, I mean, people nowadays in Iran can read this in Farsi. I mean, Farsi is conservative grammatically. So it's not like somebody in England trying to read the Doomsday Book or something like that, where it's just really, it's a different language. I mean, obviously the languages descend, but it's, you know, Anglo-Saxon and early Norman French are very difficult for just a person who's an English speaker. Whereas in Iran, you can just go and pick this up and read it. The problem is, like, the vocabulary, there are words in there that haven't survived, so we don't know what they mean exactly. And there are words that have survived, but their meaning's changed.
Yeah.
But having said that, this still makes sense to a large degree. Yeah. And you can see this intertwining of you know, like, sciences, which astronomy, astrology was at the time. I use a double term, because what was the astrology part gradually got less important. I mean, by the time you get to Timur's grandson, Ulugbek, I mean, we had people in Khorasan, and Ulugbek was one of them, who were writing serious astronomical tables at a level that they were translated into European languages, because nobody had done it that well. So what we've got is that a person who is a scientist,
yeah,
thinks that there are all these significant things about archery, as aside from its use as a weapon. And he's very aware of its practical use as a weapon.
Yeah.
But he sees this deeper meaning that you can get from bows and arrows.
Yeah.
And, you know, this might be the Persian equivalent of Zen and the art of archery. I don't know. But it's got this kind of depth,
yeah,
that's unusual. The later books have religious references, but they're more stock references. This is more analytical, even though I can't understand a lot of the things he's talking about. I can see that he has a clear idea of where he's, yeah, going. It's just that, yeah, we don't have the knowledge to really understand. It would be like me reading a book on quantum computers. I mean, I understand computers, I understand a bit of quantum physics, but the conceptualization of the interface between the two is beyond me at the moment. And, you know, I might not live long enough to be smart enough to understand that. I'm not going to give up, but you've got to, you know, we've got this stuff that is so, and I mean, again, this is less than two pages in your book.
Yeah.
Yet it's got so much in those two pages.
It does.
Some of it's so practical, like the weights of bows and crossbows and siege machines, that it's a potential for recreating the weapons. There's Arabic manuals that have descriptions of siege weapons and things like that. There's descriptions of crossbows. There are, like, the Hilyat Rami has information on crossbows as well. So that's both sides of Iran. Like the Egyptians under the Ayyubids and the Mamluks wrote about crossbows. The Persians in Delhi, well, the people writing in Persian in Delhi who were Persian descendants, were writing about crossbows. There are illustrations from the 1700s of crossbows to one of these manuscripts, you know, a copy of the manuscript that was done a couple of hundred years. Like the Hidayat Arami was written in 1500. The Kuliat Arami was written in the 1700s, I think, mid-1700s. And the illustrations, there are illustrations done in a later version of the Hilyat Arami showing crossbows, showing a guy sitting on the ground with both feet extended, reaching forward to pull the string back.
Yes.
And so this is interesting because by and large, there's not a lot of information about crossbows in art. The Zafar Nama about Timur, one of the illustrated ones from just prior to the Safavid dynasty, which was done quite late in the Timurid period, shows the siege of Smyrna in Anatolia, and there are crossbows on both sides. The Smyrna was held by the Knights Hospitaller, I think, and the Timur's army. They both have crossbows, and they're stirrup crossbows. I think in Arabic, Kas al Rikab, these weren't strange, but they weren't as common as handbows. And the fact that this Kamane Baland, I think I've seen this in several other references, the longbow. In Arab archery, there's a long discussion about longbows and shortbows, because of the fact that it's quite obvious that the author of that was using the terminology either to mean the physical length of the bow or the brace height of the bow. So a longbow could be a bow with a big brace height, or it could be a long bow. And he was cavalier about how he used that. So you've got to read the text very carefully to work out which one he meant. One of the problems of translation when the author isn't consistent. See, today, when you're writing, you've got your computer and you can go through and you can make sure every time you use a word, you are using it with the same meaning.
Yeah.
But when you're writing it out by hand or dictating to a scribe, you can't do that. You've got to get it all clear in your head and just go for it and hope for the best.
Yeah.
And these manuscripts, when they're copied, often the person copying them sees something and thinks it's a mistake and changes it.
Yeah,
and thereby changes the whole meaning of the sentence.